Hello, I'm Dr. John Curry, and I have a word for you this morning. And the word is entitled, The Kingdom Story, The Necessity of Jesus Christ. You know, Romans 3 and 23 says, For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Romans 5 and 8 says, But God commanded his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Romans 6 and 23 says, For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Romans 10 and 9 says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God had raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Well, the message for today is the necessity of Jesus Christ. We live in a world where people think that Christ is no longer needed, that he's no longer viable, that his death was all a sham. But what God has for you today is going to bless your heart and uplift your spirits. And stay tuned for the Conqueror's Message. I am the conqueror.
Through him that loves me.
Hello, I'm Dr. John Curry. I come to bear witness that there is no other God but Jehovah, and that Jesus Christ is his only Son, a prophet, and Savior of the world, that there is no other name whereby men shall be saved, but by and through the name of Jesus Christ. And at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ, the only Son of the most sovereign, omnipotent God is Lord. May God grace and mercy be unto the world and to my kingdom, brothers and sisters. Peace be unto you and God be glorified. Welcome to the Conqueror's Message. We have a word for you this morning that we believe is going to bless your heart and bless your soul. And we trust that you can receive this word in the spirit of which it is given. The word or the message is entitled, The Kingdom Story and the Necessity of Jesus Christ. Once before time, God, who lived in the third heaven with all of his heavenly hosts, decided to make a colony of his kingdom in the earth. God appointed the anointed cherub that covers, named Lucifer, to make ready for the kingdom of heaven to be colonized in the earth. Lucifer's assignment was in Eden, the garden of God, that is found in Genesis chapter 2, verse 15. He was decked with every precious stone was his covering. The sardius, the topaz, the diamond, the barclay, the onyx, and the jasper. The sapphire, the embryo, the carbuncle in gold. The workmanship of his tapers and of his pipes was prepared in him in the day that he was created. He was the anointed cherub that covers, and God had set him so. He was upon the holy mountain of God and walked up and down in the midst of the stones of fire. He was perfect in his ways from the day that he was created until iniquity was found in him. That's Ezekiel chapter 28, verses 13 through 15. While in Eden, Lucifer decided in his heart that he would go against God. And Lucifer said, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the south of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like God. That's found in Isaiah chapter 14, verses 12 through 19. Lucifer in his madness was ready to commit treason on the God who created him. He went up to make war in heaven, and Michael and the warring angels fought against the dragon, and they fought. Revelations 12, 7 through 9. In defeat, dishonor, and disgrace, Lucifer's name was changed from Satan to the devil. Jesus said, I beheld Satan fall as lightning from heaven to hell, to the side of the pit. Luke chapter 10, verse 18. Satan turned off the power in the earth, disconnecting the kingdom of God, and God went out on a mission in order to bring back what the devil was trying to mess up. Genesis chapter 1, verse 2 says, and God says, let there be light, and it was light. God reconnected the kingdom of heaven to the earth by a spoken word. When he spoke the word, whatever he said came into fruition. In order for God to continue his plan of colonizing the earth, God thought within himself and within the foreknowledge of his mind and the Godheads. And God said, let us make man. And after God said, let us make man, so God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. And when God created them, he gave and told them to be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. And no sooner than God had given them that instruction, that old devil was watching everything that God was saying. The devil was sitting back and watching God create a being that was different from himself. He was watching God create a being that looked different and talked different and acted different, but it was God's creation. And Satan himself did not say anything unto Adam. Satan just waited and waited. And after God had made man, God saw that man needed a helpmeet. And the Bible records that God put Adam to sleep. And when he put him to sleep, he took from him a rib, and thereby he made woman. And when he brought the woman to the man, God thereby saw Adam smile. And when Adam smiled, Adam began to say, this is now bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. Adam was satisfied by what he saw, because Satan, the devil, had messed up the connection from the kingdom of heaven into the earth. And since Satan disconnected the power from heaven to the earth, God was looking for another connection. And he found that he could use that connection, and that connection was man himself. So God gave man authority to have dominion over the fish of the sea, to have dominion over the fowls of the air, and to have dominion over every creeping thing that moveth upon the earth. And God's instruction to Adam and Eve was to be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. That's found in Genesis chapter 1, verse 27 through 28. God saw something that he did not see in Lucifer, but what he saw in man. And what he saw in man was a being that was connected directly to him. And all the man had to do was follow the instructions of God. God instructed Adam not to eat of the tree of the fruit of the knowledge of good and evil. Adam thereby passed the message on to his wife Eve. And we know the story, how the enemy came to Eve and began to deceive her, saying, you shall not surely die. It's amazing that we have to be careful with who we listen to, because the devil will speak to you and make you think what's truth is not truth at all. It's all hidden and supported by a lie. And when Satan told Eve, ye shall not surely die, he was mixing truth with a lie, because he knew that the moment that she ate of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, death was already beginning to take place. No, she didn't die literally, she died spiritually. She was beginning to die from the moment that she ate of the fruit. But the scripture said that she gave to her husband and he did eat. He ate right along with her, committing the second disconnection of the kingdom of heaven and the earth. Remember, Lucifer disconnected the kingdom of heaven and the earth. Now Adam is disconnecting the kingdom of heaven and the earth. But God being God, went out on a divine redemption mission. God immediately releases divine redemption mission plan to reconnect the kingdom of God in the earth. To reconnect it, God was interested in bringing heaven into the earth. In order to do that, he needed someone in the earth to bring the kingdom of heaven into the earth. So he reconnected it. He needed someone to come and to save men from sin. So God thought within himself, and God said to himself, I will give myself in representation of my son. And God became incarnated, wrapped himself up in flesh, came down into the earth. Then God said to Satan, I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. Genesis 3 and 15. God was on a mission to bring forth the righteous seed. Satan was on a mission to destroy the righteous seed. And Satan was on a mission so that man would be destroyed and never fulfill the will and the purposes of God. Therefore, God had to establish kingdom covenants and righteous generation in order to bring forth the righteous seed and take away man's sin. God is interested in removing sin. He's interested in taking sin out of our lives. He's interested in removing sin from us. So from the time of Adam, God established righteous covenants. He established covenants of righteous generation. So thereby his covenant was with Adam to Seth, from Seth to Enoch, from Enoch to Noah, from Noah to Shem, from Shem to Peleg, from Peleg to Abram, from Abram to Isaac, from Isaac to Jacob, from Jacob to Judah, from Judah to David, from David to Nathan, and from Nathan to Mary, who said to the angel Gabriel, be it unto me according to thy words. So in this kingdom story, we see that Jesus was and still is necessary. Jesus is not a figment of our imagination. Jesus is not some man over here in the back, in the dark, in the corner. Jesus shouldn't play the role of our Santa Claus. He shouldn't play the role that when we want something that we go to him. Jesus shouldn't play the role that, you know, that he's only necessary when we need him necessarily. Jesus shouldn't be some comic fixture. He shouldn't play the role of Superman or Batman. Jesus is real. And when he died for your sin, he died because you was on your way to hell. He's real. Know this. When you was born to go to hell. And the only reason why your destination have changed is if you have accepted Jesus as your personal Savior. When you understand that you was born to go to hell, and the mere fact that Jesus came into your life, that you have right now to go to heaven, you then understand what this is all about. So Jesus came. He is necessary. When he died for our sins and rose again from the dead on the third day. When he rose from the dead on the third day, he gave us grace. And we have grace to live in the kingdom of God. You are an ambassador for Christ if you accepted Christ as your personal Savior. You are appointed by the king, committed only to the king's interest, and that is to colonize the earth until Jesus returns. You embody the kingdom protection of his government. You have the kingdom power and authority to rule with voice activation for kingdom domination. You shall have what you say. You are saved by grace through faith. It is a gift of God. You are redeemed and justified by grace. You have grace that will allow you to live in the kingdom without shame, guilt, or fear. You have grace that is not a license to sin, but to be cleansed. Grace is for you when you stumble and fall. Grace will pick you up. Grace is the oxygen that you need in order to live a holy life. You can't live by the law, but you can be justified and broken by grace. You have death and life in your mouth. Now speak life. You are delivered by what you say. You have the amazing grace of God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Your voice is kingdom activated to get results now. You are growing in grace 24/7, 365. You have grace to preach the gospel. You have grace that would build you up. You have grace that would produce obedience. You have grace that would keep you strong in God. You have grace to come in. You have grace to come out. When you accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, God has given you his amazing grace. So Jesus is necessary for you right now. You must receive him now as your personal Savior. And when you receive him, you have grace to live right, grace to talk right. You have grace that would allow you to live in the kingdom of God without any shame, guilt, or fear. You have grace that is not a license to sin, but grace allows you to be cleansed. You have grace, for when you stumble and fall, it will be grace that will pick you up. You must understand that grace is the oxygen that you need in order to live a holy life. You can't live by the law, but you can be broken by grace. You have death and life in your mouth. Now you must learn to speak life. You are delivered by what you say. You have the amazing grace of God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Your voice is kingdom activated to get results now. What if you just decide to start speaking things into fruition rather than worrying about what people say and start declaring what you want out of your mouth? Death and life is in your tongue. What you say, you shall have. What you speak, you can receive. You must understand that God gave you a voice activation system. You will have what you say. You have grace to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. You have grace that when you fall down, it'll build you back up. You have grace that will produce obedience. Grace is not a license to sin, but to be cleansed. So grace should produce obedience. You should get to the point in your life where you no longer want to sin anymore. No longer want to do wrong anymore. No longer want to lie or cheat anymore. Because God's amazing grace will build you to the point where you realize that I can't do this anymore. Grace is not permission. Grace is something that allows you to be healed from the inside out. It is the law that is a revealer. But grace is a healer. The law reminds us that we can do no better. We can't live by the law, but we can be broken by grace. You have that grace. You have that amazing grace. You have the grace that supplies all of your needs. You have the grace that to forgive others when they do you wrong. You have great power because you have great grace. You should never put new wine into old skins. You should never put grace, the new wine, into the law, the old skin. You are bounding into grace. I know the enemy may think that there's no hope for you. He may try to get you to figure out that, you know, I'm not going to get any better. All I do is grin and sin. He may try to make you think that no matter how your life is going, nobody loves you, nobody cares. But I want you to know that Jesus is necessary. I don't care what you're in, he's able to bring you out. I don't care how bad you are, he's able to make you good. I don't care what they said or what they did or what they've done. His amazing grace will pull you out of the pit of a hard life. Jesus is necessary, and he's necessary for you. Yeah, I know you see a lot of comics and people making jokes about Jesus. Some of them got him still on the cross, and some of them got him as a babe in a manger. But we're talking about Yeshua. We're talking about Yeshua HaMashiach. He is Jesus the Messiah. He is the risen one. He now sits on the throne and pleads for you. He sits on the throne and has an advocate for you. He sits on the throne and intercedes for you. He sits on the throne and asks God to please give him another chance. It is Jesus that keeping you alive even today. And he's doing it through his amazing grace. Don't take it for granted. Don't sit back and act like everything is going well. Yeshua, the King, is soon to return. And those of you that are hearing this word, God is giving you a warning that Jesus Christ is soon to come. All you have to do is look at the atmosphere. Look around you. Look at the people. Look at the places. Look at the world. Look at the world. See what's around you. You can see that Yeshua is soon to come. He's coming quickly. He's coming quicker than at once. You're not going to have time to get ready. You need to be ready. You're not going to have time to put the drugs down. You're not going to have time to put the joint down. You're not going to have time to tell that prostitute, that whore. You're not going to have time to get your life together. You need to get your life together now. Because the Bible says he's going to come quicker than a flashing of an eye, a blinking of an eye. Yeshua is coming. You can think it's a joke if you want to. You can think you can be saved by yourself. You can think that you can just skip on through life and you're not going to have to pay the price. But hell was not meant for human beings. Hell was meant for the devil and his angels. But as I told you earlier, you were born into sin and hell is your destination. Unless you accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, you are on your way to hell. But he's giving you his grace. He's giving you his love. What else do we need to give you? He's giving you everything you need to turn your life around. No matter how life has treated you, no matter what you've been through, no matter what they said or what they did, it does not matter. When you have Christ in your life, he's willing and he's able to forgive you of all your sins and to cleanse you from all your unrighteousness. You have the power to change your life through the amazing grace of God by merely accepting Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. Do it today. Don't wait till tomorrow, for tomorrow is not promised. Do it now. Do it today. Repeat after me. Romans 10 and 9, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thine heart that God raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. If you repeated those scriptures and you say, Heavenly Father, I ask you to come into my life. I ask you to forgive me of all of my sins. And I ask you, Father, to keep me from sinning again. Help me to live a clean life. And I do believe that Jesus was risen from the dead. If you prayed that prayer, I tell you this day, you are now saved. Your destination is no longer hell, but your destination is now heaven. I trust God that you made that commitment and that you committed to God today. I just want you to know that Jesus Christ is necessary for you in your life. And let him come and rule your life. And as he rule your life, he can move you forward and have you to be all that you intend to be. Rest in Jesus. He is not a figment of your imagination. He is real. And he died for your sins. And when you accept him as your personal Savior, you shall go and be with him again. I trust God that you got something out of this word. And I trust that you will tune in and be with us again. And remember this, Jesus Christ is truly necessary. God bless. Until next time. Hello, I'm Dr. John Curry, pastor founder of Conquerors Christian Center, along with my wife, Dr. Sheila Curry, co-pastor. We're glad that you tuned in with us today, and we trust that the Conqueror's message will inspire you to be motivated to help us build the kingdom of God in the earth. We are kingdom citizens who are part of the body of Christ worldwide. As true believers, we are brothers and sisters in the kingdom of God. Our focus is always on kingdom building as we reach out to those who are lost.
Our gathering place is called The Fort, Conquerors Christian Center, 200 East Washington, Belleville, Illinois, a family church, home of the Conquerors. We are in covenant with God through Abraham and Jesus Christ. Our mission is building those of tomorrow today as we serve people and change lives, conquering to advance the kingdom of God.
Conquerors Christian Center is where kingdom citizens come together of all race, background, to re-up on faith, hope, and love, and being deployed back into the community to operate in the full nine manifestation of the Holy Spirit for kingdom colonization until Jesus returns. We believe all Christians are conquerors and more than conquerors through Jesus Christ. As conquerors, we have three weapons: the Holy Spirit, fearlessness, and the presence of God.
We hope this message will inspire you to turn your life over to Jesus Christ and let him be your general and high priest of your soul.
Come and visit with us at The Fort, Conquerors Christian Center, a family church, home of the Conquerors, where you will receive the Word of God with simplicity, clarity, and understanding. And that Word will inspire you to go and kingdom build as we build the kingdom of God together. God bless, and we'll continue to be praying for you. Thank you for listening to the Conqueror's Message. It is our hope that this message will inspire you to pursue the kingdom of God and be all that God intends for you to be. Conquerors Christian Center is located at 200 East Washington, Belleville, Illinois. Our phone number there is 618-277-5671. Our services are as follows: Sunday morning worship service, 10 a.m. Wednesday night Bible study and discipleship class, 7 p.m. Thursday night youth night, The Mighty Warriors for Christ, 7 p.m. Now may Yahweh bless thee and keep thee. May Yahweh make his face to shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. May Yahweh lift up his countenance upon thee. And may Yahweh, Yedidim, his beloved sons and daughters, give you his children, his peace. Until next time, I'm Pastor Curry. Be a conqueror. Experience it. It's contagious. God bless. Until next time.